What's up, my dudes? This is Dustin Stelzer with Electrician U, and today I'm finally replacing my old service. Oh my gosh. I have had a Zinsco panel on my house. This house was built in 1968 when I moved in. It was one of the first things I noticed about it. First house I've ever bought, but I was like, that panel needs to go. But I mean, I opened everything up when I moved in. I checked everything out, checked the bus, checked all the breaker connections. There was no sign of overheating. There was no like charred, you know, like anything was arcing or getting hot for a very, very long time. So the nature of everything looked like it was fine. So I've been living here for 5 years. No problems whatsoever. Everything trips when it's supposed to. And I've done a number of things to make the breakers trip. So I've tested the system. I don't see anything wrong with it. But you are going to see me take an old Zinsco system out and put a brand new Square D system in. The first thing that I did was take down the existing riser. So this riser was not held in place very well. I had a bunch of old flathead screws that I had to take off, but I started to remove all of the screws, take the straps off, get the riser loose, and then I started to take the meter can itself apart, and same thing, just take the screws out. What I wanted to do was take the riser and the meter can all as one assembly, take it all down. I think it was just easier that way rather than having to take every single little coupling and fitting and lock ring and everything apart. It just saved time by being able to take the entire thing as one assembly apart. Next thing I did was start taking all of the wires off of all of the existing breakers. That way I could pull the entire panel off in one piece. So I took all of the hots off of all of the breakers. I took all of the neutrals off the buses, all the grounds off the buses, and I kind of got them all into one big bunch. And then I took the screws out and popped the panel off and dropped that onto the ground. Now the panel that I'm going to be replacing it with is a 200 amp panel, so it's a little bit bigger. It's a main breaker rather than the old panel didn't even have a main breaker. It was just buses, so you kind of had to like feed a breaker to feed the buses. This is a main breaker panel, but the coolest thing is that it's a plug-on neutral panel. So this is a new thing. This is all I use out in the field when I'm wiring new houses. All I use is plug-on neutral now, because when you're working with arc fault, dual function, ground fault breakers, rather than having all of these pigtails running up that you gotta sit and like stick your screwdriver in and pull them out to try to straighten them out. And then, you know, if you have to like move breakers around in the panel, you got all these stupid pigtails you gotta try to like fish out. They have this new plug-on neutral system. So basically where the breaker snaps into the panel is a neutral bus. There's a neutral bus on each side. And when the breaker snaps in, it already makes a connection with neutral. So literally all you do is you run your home runs in, snap them onto the breakers, and you're done. So it removes one step in the process. It saves you a lot of time if you have to like move things around. It just makes so much more sense. Plus you don't have all the stupid pigtail things. Like the pigtails annoy the living hell out of me. So I'm super happy to have that. Before I put my panel up, I need to make sure that I get my nipple put in place. I'm putting a 2-inch nipple between the meter can and the panel. So I'm gonna attach my nipple to the panel and get everything knocked out. There's little holes that I need to get punched out so that the screws can go inside the panel. This is kind of a silly thing, but a lot of manufacturers put these little knockouts in their panels or in their meter cans that you have to actually punch out before you can screw the panel in place. I think it's a really silly thing. It's just extra work that we have to do. I really wish holes just came in the enclosures. It's a silly thing to not do. I don't know. It's gotta be some reason in manufacturing why they choose to do it that way, but I think it's silly. Anyways, punch out all the holes, and then I stick the panel up and put a level on it, make sure everything's level, and screw it in place. Now the reason that I'm doing the panel first is because I've already got a hole with wires sticking out of my house, so I kind of have to have that as my starting point. If I would have put the meter can up first, then the panel might not have actually lined up, so I had to put the panel up. The first thing that I noticed right away is when I put the panel up, now all my conductors are too short. So the conductors that were in my existing panel were sized and cut for that application, but I have a larger panel. So that's going to be a problem. I'm going to have to figure that out as we go. And we'll talk a little bit about the options a little bit later when we get to that. Now that I've got my panel up, it's time to put the meter can up. So I'm using an Eaton meter can. I stick a level on that, make sure that it's also level, stick four screws in it, and then I'm going to put a bonding bushing on the inside of the meter can. The reason I do this is because this is what my utility calls for. There's some jurisdictions out there that want you to put the bonding bushing inside of the first disconnecting means, or, you know, in this case it would be the panel. Some want it on the meter side. Some have concentric knockouts or eccentric knockouts, so there's different reasons why this might be required a certain way or another. Here's a code reference if you want to look at a little bit more about this bonding bushing thing and the eccentric and concentric knockouts. But essentially what this bonding bushing is doing is it is bonding the nipple between the meter can and the service panel. And in my application, that bonding needs to happen on the inside of the meter can. Now that I've got the meter can and the panel installed, it's time to put my riser up. So I'm going to have a riser that is now going to extend up and through my eave and go above my roof, whereas the other one was far too low. You could literally walk under it and reach up and touch it. So I'm trying to get my wires a lot higher. So I'm actually gonna go with a riser that's 12'6" to the weatherhead from the ground. And I'm gonna put a new point of attachment that's above 10 feet. So the rule is that you need to have a point of attachment at 10 feet. That's a minimum though. Again, code is always minimums. There's nothing wrong with going higher than that. It's all about traffic and clearance underneath the conductor. So higher is even better. So I'm actually gonna bring my point of attachment probably to like 11.5 feet. Now that I've got the riser up, I need to secure it. It's pretty well secured in place, but we also need to strap per code. We need to put one strap within 30 inches of the termination and one every 10 feet. In this case, I'm just putting two within 10 feet because I think it's gonna secure it better. So I'm putting one up near the top and one down by the bottom. What I'm using is Unistrut or Kindorf or Channel. There's like 700 names, Cantrus, tons of different names for what this stuff is called. And then I'm gonna put strut straps on it. This is the way that I'm choosing to secure this to the wall. Once I get the strut straps on there, everything is up on the wall. It is secure, it is mounted to the wall really well. So now it's time to put my conductors in the conduit, get my conductors up to the weatherhead and put the weatherhead on. So first thing I do is feed my black conductor. In my jurisdiction, we use NEC colors. So we're using black on the left, red on the right. Some places like in Austin, which is very near where I live, it's red on the left, black on the right. But for my purposes, we're going black on the left. So the first thing I do is I feed my black conductor up. I want to make sure that I have enough of this conductor sticking out, probably about 3 to 4 feet, so that a drip loop can be made for the utility company to have a little bit of slack to hook their conductors up to. Next wire I'm going to put up is my neutral. So I tape that white. When you're taping, I stick it up the hole. I want to make sure that once the conductor shoots out the top, that I have the same length on all of the conductors.
I like to score around one time and then scrape down. Thing pulls right off.
Last thing I'm going to do is run my red conductor, and we're going to shoot the red conductor up again, making sure that it's the same length as the white and the black. cut it with the ratchet cutters and terminate it into the meter can. So now we have the line side of the meter can terminated. Now that I've got these conductors landed, I'm going to go up top, make sure that my flashing is put on the roof, and finish my weatherhead so that that's the last thing that I have to do up on the roof, and I don't have any more roof work that I need to do. Everything else I can come back down on the ground and finish out the rest of my day just coasting, essentially. I usually put my weatherhead on facing the direction of the service drop, so I will usually point it right at the pole. You don't have to do that, but that's just my preference, and some utilities, they want you to do that. So for inspection purposes, you may have to do that, but you may not have to. It's just a personal preference. I definitely point my point of attachment in the same direction because I want that tension that's coming from that pole to be directly held. I don't want there to be any tension that's pulling at a 90 degree angle or anything weird like that. I want it to be directly pointing at where that tension is coming from. My service does not require me to put any cables or guys up there. This is like 2.5 feet off the rooftop, so there's no length of my mast where it's going to be substantial to make sure that we have this secured with cables and guys. So now I'm going to go back down on the ground. It's time to put the service entrance conductors in. So now I'm going to put my black, my red, and my white in. I'm going to try to run these as neat as possible. You're always going to come off the bottom side of your meter can with these conductors, and I try to do it pretty because this is the easiest thing to make look really good and to make a service look really good with these big wires being very present. When I bend everything, I make nice curved loops. I think it just comes out looking cleaner when you do that. All right, so that's all I had time for. In the interest of not making this a 30-minute video, or longer as I tend to do, I'm going to cut this into a second part. So the next couple of days, you're going to see the other part, part two of this video, where we finish putting the breakers in, getting all the conductors actually landed, kind of ripping out the panel, and then the little finishing touches. So look forward to that video. Thank you guys so much. I appreciate all of your attention. Let me know if you have any comments, questions, concerns. Make sure that you hit the notification bell, like, subscribe, all that jazz. Love you crazy people, and I'll see you in the next one.